honored and grateful to have you here, and we very much look forward to this opportunity to learn from you as well. The title of the High Commissioner, I should read as well, is Cultural Diplomacy in the Commonwealth, The Soft Power Within. Please, Your Excellency.
Thank you very much, Mark, and I don't mind you pronouncing my name wrongly. It doesn't offend me in any way, shape, or form. Because I've been called worse things in my life, so it doesn't matter. Well, the first name is Euripides. Okay, Euripides. Evriviades, but anglicized becomes Euripides, just as Evropi, anglicized becomes Europe. Yeah. All right? Last name is not as difficult as it looks if you break it up, Evriviades, like in everything and whatever. But anyhow, really, jokes aside, I'm not going to be able to keep up such a wonderful act that Jonathan made. I've been asked to talk to you about cultural diplomacy in the Commonwealth 2016 as a means to build bridges between the Commonwealth and the world, and the cultural diplomacy from within, which I tend to just address. Mark, how much time do we have at our disposal? Because, you know, people want to maybe relax. Okay. Yeah, yeah. No, because I also want to go through a Q&A, question and answers. Yeah. And of course, you have had all the topical answers to the questions on Brexit, because to Brexit or not to Brexit, that was the question. Whether it is noble in the eyes of men, I have to recite my Shakespeare and see how we can put this on Brexit. We are where we are on Brexit. As Cyprus, I mean, we did not want this to happen. We did not want Brexit to happen. We had an opinion because it affected us and affects us as well, but we did not have a say, because at the end of the day, people decided, and as the Romans used to say, salus populi suprema lex exto, the will of the people is the supreme law. But anyhow, things are not as simple as that, and of course Brexit is affecting the United Kingdom. Brexit is affecting all the member states in the European Union. Brexit is affecting the Commonwealth. But okay, I'm not here to talk about that, even though I'll be more than happy to entertain questions on Brexit as well, or diplomacy, or anything you care to talk about, or specifically on cultural diplomacy. I thank you for this kind invitation. And as Mark said, the Association of Cyprus with the Institute is a long one, a long-standing. It's a great pleasure to be given this opportunity to address you. I have been in the diplomatic service of my country since 1976. I'm not going to go through all that has already been said. It's a journey that all of us go through. All of us have our personal journeys, our professional journeys. And any journey has its ups and downs, and any journey, at the end of the day, enriches oneself. Many ways, I don't know if you know Konstantin Kavafi, his classic poem, Ithaca. If you have the time, look it up, and you will find a lot of yourselves in that poem. And that also, the one that speaks to me, the journey, not necessarily the destination. It's not going from point A to point B. It's the journey that you go through, the fights that you have within yourselves, within yourself, how many times you fall down, but also how many times you get up. So I have a narrative, for whatever interest might be to others, because when I started my diplomacy in 1976, many of you were not born, okay? But it was a totally different world. A totally different world. And the world has changed and is changing. If there is anything permanent in the world, is that everything changes and nothing remains the same. The classic author Herodotus that spoke about these words more than 2,000 years ago. What is permanent is change. And the ones that will survive, if I am to bring several centuries in front of us, the ones that will survive will not be the strongest of the species, as Darwin would have said, but the ones that adapt to change. So, Brexit is Brexit. We have to adapt to it and see where we go forward. But I'm going to be talking to you about cultural diplomacy and what that means within the Commonwealth and how that is being used correctly, sometimes not correctly, in order to achieve certain goals. Now, I will attempt to marry the subject of cultural diplomacy with digital diplomacy, on the basis that both cultural and digital diplomacies rely on a presupposition of equality, and thus can be combined with each other harmoniously to achieve foreign policy goals. At least this is the theory. And in theory, there's no difference between theory and practice. In practice, often there is. And I'm speaking to you as a practitioner and not and as an academician, and certainly not as a world renowned and rich journalist like Jonathan is. I am a practitioner. I mean, I have to see some immediate results, even though we, you know, marriage processes are long-term processes and you don't see immediate results. I mean, if I shine my pair of shoes, I'm happy because I see immediate results. Sometimes I don't see these results, and there are frustration that comes with it. I will give examples of such digital cultural diplomacy from different countries, in the notable major example within the Commonwealth, and a little bit of my own. I will discuss the potential of cultural diplomacy for the Commonwealth as an organization, both internally by its own member states and externally on how these relate to building bridges between our Commonwealth family and the world. At the end, I will naturally try to answer some of your questions, some of your reflections, with the disclaimer up front that I am not an expert in the field, I am not an academician, I repeat, I'm a practitioner, with benefits of being a practitioner, but also serious downsides and downfalls. And part of the downfall, I was saying to my collaborator, Christina, is that if my professors were to see some of the cables I sent back home, I'm sure they would take my degree back. Because they will say, listen, Euripides, you actually learn nothing because you're not exercising critical thinking. And sometimes I would say, I'm not paid to think. I am paid to do a job and carry out my instructions. But that doesn't mean, of course, you are an automatic pilot and you're a good post person. They send you instructions, and as a good postman, you go and you parrot it, and that's the end of that. It's a much more. Try to think now that I'm all trying to put it all in terms of cultural diplomacy, because I want to remain as much as possible focused. It is suggested among historical and sociological circles that our world in the 21st century is, to an extent, a consequence of cultural diplomacy dating back millennia. One, of course, could argue, for example, that biology wouldn't have been the same had the Greeks not constructed the great library of Alexandria in 3rd century before Christ. Iliad and Odyssey are still being taught to children and young people around the world and promulgate the same Homeric values. The Romans gave us law. That is why it has been said that we think Greek, but we live Roman. The Hindu scripture of Bhagavad Gita, thought to have been written around 4000 BCE, before Common Era, is still influencing our modern world. And of course, so does the Bible, the Talmud, the Quran, and so many others. Some may question that religion is not cultural diplomacy, but I would argue that cultural diplomacy is a wide term that also brings in religion, brings arts, brings music, brings ideas. Okay? Many Balkan countries wouldn't be practicing Orthodox Christianity, for instance, had it not been for the activities of medieval Byzantine missionaries. Our world has changed and is changing dramatically. No accident that people call it a global village. An act of aggression and a terrorism in Bali, in one end of the world, affects the other end of the world. And whereas it is no longer correct or indeed acceptable to impose one's own culture on others, assimilate or proselytize culture, is still a soft power, which is used by governments often as an instrument of diplomacy to achieve foreign policy goals. But these goals are often not immediate, or the achievement of these goals are not immediate, and it takes time to mature and it takes time to bring it forth, because often it is said, I know these things are buzzwords, but there is meaning behind them. What is defined as real has real consequences. So the definition of reality comes through the definition of the image, name branding. Some people will call it mind conditioning. Orwell would have said several different things about the mind and how the mind is being formulated. Okay? So it's not just, as I often receive, okay, culture is something innocent, it is, but one has to critically think what cultural diplomacy at the end means. There are some very, very positive things that come with it, but there are some negatives as well. We live in the century of personal freedom. At least we're supposed to be living in personal freedom. It is of crucial importance to make room for intellectual dialogue, constant exchange of ideas. This thought that there is a clash of civilizations, Samuel Huntington, Professor Huntington's classic book, very often one can turn it around and say, not a clash of civilizations, but much more a clash of ignorance, because we haven't really studied each other's culture. We haven't really put ourselves into somebody else's shoes and see things from their own perspective. One has to proceed, of course, with intercultural dialogue, exchange of ideas, and of course not try to paternalistically impose anything on anybody else, because that is cultural imperialism. And imperialism, in all its forms and manifestation, is something not good. What about the state as a cultural diplomacy actor and factor? States within the Commonwealth, states outside of the Commonwealth, EU. Okay? Government involvement in cultural diplomacy, especially after centuries of forced cultural exportation and assimilation of overseas peoples, if not used carefully, could backfire and bring in memories of other imperialistic actions, including, of course, cultural imperialism, with the evils associated with empires and the evils associated with imperialism and all the evils associated with it, whether this was the Ottoman Empire, whether this was the British Empire, whether it was Alexander the Great Empire, for that matter. I'm not trying to now say all empires and all imperial cultural imperialism has, of course, its all negative sides. For this very reason, to keep its non-binding nature intact and undoubted, cultural diplomacy was institutionalized towards the end of the 19th century with specialized cultural institutions such as the British Council, Alliance Française, Instituto Cervantes, Instituto Italiano di Cultura, Goethe Institute, to mention but a few. The state was doing it, and now in the 19th century, specialized cultural institutions, which are associated, of course, with governments, but are also our NGOs too. They have their autonomy. They will not get instructions from the government, even though you always have to go back to funding. Who is funding these institutions, and what is their agenda? As they say, another buzz line, another buzzword, and another slogan, but meaning within slogans is, whoever pays the piper calls the tune. So one has to go beyond and see what is behind. Now, these are the institutes that I named, some of the institutes that have made cultural diplomacy more appealing. It was carried out by autonomous entities, not enforced, as I said, by government. It was within the help that, for instance, the help of the Goethe Institute, founded in 1951, that post-Nazi Germany managed not to only break with its totalitarian past, but also reemerge with a positive image, becoming a leading country in national brand today. So think what Germany, the Idefix, think of the image that Germany had, World War I, World War II. Think how many wars the EU has had, and think how the whole thing progressed. It progressed among others, because of cultural diplomacy. Not the only factor. It's a combination of factors that brought the EU where it is today, brick by brick. But one should not underestimate the cultural diplomacy that brings in understanding, that brings in familiarity, that brings in tolerance. I say cultural diplomacy, passport to peace. Cultural diplomacy as done within correctly and as done, as we said before, in its proper context. Now, in today's interconnected world, equality of opportunity is reflected by and large online. As long as you have an Ethernet cable, not internet, but internet, but Ethernet cable, a Wi-Fi connection, or a good data plan with your carrier, you get the chance to voice and express yourself. Who you are and what defines you. Who is your country and what defines it? In the case of small countries, digital diplomacy and cultural diplomacy helps them fight their corner more effectively. Hence, that's why I hesitantly but for surely joined the digital age. I came to the 21st century from the Stone Age, and I've left several centuries behind, but I am there on Twitter land. I just do Twitter because it's, you know, if you start doing all the other social media, it's just simply mind-boggling. Already Twitter for me is time-consuming. But I'm there. Why am I there? Because I believe it is a modern tool of diplomacy. It gives me some exposure, whatever that might mean. I'm able to reach certain audience that I'm not able to do immediately, and it helps me fight my corner. And within that mix, obviously I will promote the politics, but I will also promote the country's culture. When somebody looks on my Twitter feed, they cannot really make it out. Is this guy a diplomat? Is he an energy expert? Is he an archaeologist? Is he a tourist agent? Well, all our job as high commissioners, as ambassadors, is of course to inject our public persona into the promotion and the protection of the holistic interests of the state. Okay? But representing a small country, it means that you have to work double shift. And especially in my own case, because half of my country is divided, half of the country is under military occupation. Okay? Now, let's go to a specific example. Let me say that digital diplomacy and cultural diplomacy both operate on this presupposition of universality of opportunities. You have a free platform, you don't have to pay for it. A has as equal chance as B to be out there, to be in that space. You do not need a million to be in that space. It is given to you free. But is it given to you free? Is there a price that you pay? Okay? Now, it is no coincidence that the EU Parliament proposed, through a resolution in 2011, the creation of a Directorate General within the European Action Service, under which both cultural and digital diplomacy would fall. Erasmus program being a case in point, in which the distinguished speaker that preceded me mentioned. Now, let's go to the Commonwealth quickly, because I want to have Q&A. It's always boring when people just talk, because the measure of a good speech, I think, is not who is talking, but who is actually listening. You know, so I do not want any chairs being moved and people getting frustrated. Now, one of the examples that I want to zero in as a best practice that could be copied by other member states of the Commonwealth, and the summation of that will help create bridges in the world, is the example of the Prime Minister of India, Modi. He introduced to us the diplomacy of yoga, which he rightfully claimed as, quote unquote, India's gift to the world, thus putting a national stamp on a practice and, for some, a way of life which is globally rising, especially among the youth. He appointed a minister for yoga to ensure his government is very serious about it. After addressing the Australian Parliament in November 2014, Prime Minister Modi told reporters, and I quote, "I know yoga is enormously popular here, We need to connect our people more. We need to connect our people more. He also discussed the benefits of yoga with the US President Barack Obama over dinner at the White House. Last but definitely not least, Modi won the support of the UN for the establishment of Yoga International Day, celebrated for the second time this year, 21st of June. Why do so much to remind millions of yoga practitioners around the world that their favorite practice with deep spiritual lifestyle implications is thoroughly Indian? As the High Commissioner of India to Australia said, a gentleman named Suri, a self-proclaimed great believer in the power of cultural diplomacy, he said, hopefully, when people think of yoga, they will think of India in a positive way. And this is exactly what Professor Joseph Nye meant in his classic book about soft power, that seduction is better than coercion. The ability, and here I quote, the seduction part is mine, and I quote him, the ability to get what you want through attraction rather than coercion or payments. Huge idea. Maybe people that are anti-American may say, America, go home, but take me home with you. That doesn't mean if somebody wears a Harley Davidson jacket could be a terrorist. It could be. But that soft power, very, very, very much underestimated. And training the mind through different programs, scholarships, Fulbright, Erasmus, and I do not know what. These things are, I think, to be studied a lot more effectively by many of us. The ones that have been studying them, they have put it down and made it an art and a science. But many of us don't really are cognizant of 100% what's going on. Now, more into the example of Modi's yoga diplomacy, it is crucial to acknowledge the role of social media in the promulgation of this message to the millions. Here we come back to the free platform. Here we come back to the citizen who is empowered by social media. I'm not going to talk about Arab Spring. We all know how that happened, with a gentleman being frustrated, burning himself up in Tunisia, was easy. Social media. I was political director at the time of Kasoulidis. Two times he was my foreign minister, two times of professional marriage, and the second marriage is even better than the first. And somebody ran into my office and he says, you know, Ambassador, there is no leader. There is nobody. It is bottom up. It is social media. It is Twitter. It is Facebook. Being in the Stone Age, I said, Facebook? I have a face. I have books. Do I have Facebook? Twitter? How does that taste? Then one realizes the power of that. Transpose that to culture. Modi is able to do that message to the millions. He would not have been able to do it otherwise. Maybe it would have taken him a lot more longer to do it, but he's there. And you know what? You can do the same thing. Okay? Now, I think it's 10 to 12. His Twitter account, Modi's Twitter account, of course, he's Prime Minister of India, so in India is 1.3, 1.4 billion persons. He has something like 22.6 million people following him. These are huge numbers. He is able to do many things with just simply one tweet, which before used to take you a long time to do, if at all. It has changed everything, so the same thing has to be done in terms of cultural diplomacy within countries of the Commonwealth, and then there's a summation of that, as I said, helps us. A digital approach to cultural diplomacy could also help us tackle radicalization and violence and extremism, because digital diplomacy, Twitterization, if I can call that, has a downside. Because those very same instruments that we have invented to make our life more simple, to make our life better, Those are the very same things that the terrorists are using against us. Those are the very same things that hatred and bullying is happening. So how the message goes, how the image goes, slowly, slowly you form a mind. And like I said, one has to be careful because the words are changing, but very often the meaning is the same. Somebody is killed by friendly fire. Oh, wow, friendly fire. He's less dead. He's as much dead. Friendly fire or no friendly fire. So one also has to be cognizant of what these things mean. Corruption. Oh, of course it's not corruption. I mean, it's a bonus. It's something extra because you're doing very work. Thank you. It is pure corruption. Okay? Now, I should not be digressing. I need to keep my focus. Otherwise, my professors will take my degree back. And this is used, of course, effectively, India, Israel, United States, Germany. Now, digital diplomacy can also be used in peace building and reconciliation. My president, for instance, and now we're having the talks for the reunification of the island, with the Turkish Cypriot leader, Mr. Akinci, a very good man, are able to also exchange messages through Twitter, through digital diplomacy and through cultural diplomacy and exchange wishes for Bayram or for Christmas or whatever. It's another means to pass the positive messages. As I said, some other messages are also negative. Now, back to the Commonwealth and we wrap it up. It is extremely significant, and we must say that, how Britain, which was after all the imperial power, and most of us fought it bitterly to get our independence, managed to create an organization of 53 sovereign and equal states through, among others, and for our purposes, the astute use of soft power through often cultural diplomacy, British Council, BBC, and so many others. When I was in Moscow during the USSR stroke Moscow years, I was there when the Soviet Union collapsed, and I was there physically when the hammer and sickle flag was coming down in Red Square and Soviet Union was no longer, okay? I was listening to the BBC constantly. A huge Sony shortwave radio, all these things that you remember. Nowadays people forget about it, these things go in the museum, but that was it. I said, well, it was said by the BBC, it must be so, okay? It was often so, often it was not so. Okay, but at any rate, it was the most accurate and the most objective as one could find. And that was the BBC. It wasn't the Soviet news agency that I would trust. That's huge. The Commonwealth is indeed a hub of diversity, a force of good in the world. Having members in all continents of the world, from all major religions and from all thousands of traditions, the Commonwealth is undoubtedly an example of coexistence, interfaith dialogue, transnational cooperation. Our Commonwealth has the experience and the potential to become a global advocate, export its very own values of coexistence to promote its own interests and those of its member states. It has not yet, however, reached its prime position to fulfill this potential. We should remain cognizant of the fact that as long as our own charter, the Commonwealth Charter, is partially implemented on democracy, human rights, the rule of law, it will be often difficult for the Commonwealth as a whole to gain the gravitas of building bridges outwardly. But that is the ideal. If I cannot reach the ideal, that doesn't mean I give up. So slowly, slowly, brick by brick, these things are built, because any charter, the United Nations Charter for that matter, is yet to be implemented. That doesn't mean just because it is not being implemented, we stop and we don't strive to that level. It also means that you redouble the efforts to reach that level. In the meantime, you do start building bridges constantly through tolerance, understanding, through exposing to others their your culture. On the light side, when I go to Botswana 50, a week ago, we were celebrating Botswana's 50th anniversary, and when I saw the films, when I saw the people dancing, a very huge, energetic reception, you know, energy and color. EU receptions are just simply boring, okay? And I said, well, it whet up my appetite to do it. So you begin to have the favorable dispositions. Now, take the Botswana example, for example. Indonesia is not a member of the Commonwealth, but the other day we had an Indonesian National Day reception. All these things need to be done in the Commonwealth in a much bigger, sustained level, individually and collectively, and through that, of course, you have the desired result. Now, recommendations, like I said, I closed with what I started at the beginning. I'm a practitioner, okay? The cat must be able to catch the mouse. Otherwise, it is famous Tom and Jerry cartoon. So we have put down on paper some recommendations. Some of them are doable, some of them are not so doable. But I'm sure in this day and age, when people land on the moon in 1969 and now to land in Mars, I'm sure these things can be done as well. A digital cultural diplomacy within the Commonwealth is very likely to bring the member states, of course, closer together and has a stone in the pond effect with the rest of the world. We have a rich pool of common history and values upon which we can draw to inspire younger generations online. The Secretariat, who is doing a good job in the Commonwealth, could use its youth and communications divisions to enhance this exchange of information in a much more sustained and result-oriented manner. The Commonwealth Secretariat and its member states could provide training for the prospective formal and informal diplomats to become digitally fluent. A stronger political initiative is needed of the Commonwealth countries, because the Commonwealth is as powerful as its member states make it to be. We shouldn't just be, you know, passing on the back constantly to the Commonwealth Secretariat, even though, you know, they're very professional people and they do a good job. A stronger political initiative is needed of the Commonwealth countries to abide by the Commonwealth Charter and by the recent report of the Human Dignity Trust in association with the Commonwealth Lawyers Association on human rights all across the board. So, a more targeted way to go forward. Until then, until we reach that, of course, there is a lot of work to be done in the digitalizing diplomacy within the Commonwealth and reaching what once was hoi polli, the many, okay? And today is the future of bottom-up politics and e-democracy. Take this and multiply it, and I think we have a better chance of achieving the bridges that we're talking about. Commonwealth is also going through its own metamorphosis. It's also going through its own self-adjustment, because in times of old, it was a more of a powerful force. But through time, things have changed. You have to be able to change with them in order to survive. Because of globalization, because of regionalization, the Commonwealth has to try double hard to have more of a relevance on the world stage, okay? And that's not the easy answer. And it's not, it is a bit of a criticism, but also a good-natured criticism, because it needs to reform, just as the United Nations, Council of Europe, OSCE need reform as well. I think I've spoken more than enough. I want to thank you for your attention. I mean, they say that a small speech moves the hearts and a long speech moves chairs. I'm happy that no chairs were moved during my presentation. Obviously, I'm ready to take some questions, and thank you again for this opportunity and for your attention.
Thank you very much, Your Excellency, and we would indeed be very happy to take questions and comments. As always, if you can briefly introduce yourself so the ambassador knows also where you're from, that would be excellent. You were the first, and then we'll come back there, please.
Thank you so much, Mark. Thank you so much, Your Excellency, for this wonderful presentation.
You are?
My name is Karim. I'm from Afghanistan.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam. I'm so delighted for being here today. It was really a great presentation that you highlighted the culture diplomacy, the digital diplomacy. But nowadays, hearing from the news, people are debating the Third World War.
Yes.
In the area that we are now feeling that we are very close to each other more than any other time. Before 10 years, we didn't have the opportunity to talk through our friends, to see them live. Now, sitting in Afghanistan, I could really join my friends in London here. But with all these tools, with all these privileges that we have today, why we are so much different today on many world issues? Do we blame the diplomacy that is currently on there? Or what do you think, what is actually the factors of seeing countries or making their blocs, they're really preparing for wars, and see the Middle East is somehow destroyed. Afghanistan, after 15 years, they're talking about another 15 years of war. What are the factors? And
your name again?
Karim.
Karim. Yeah, Karim.
Thank you.
No, Karim, it is a very powerful observation that you are making, because in one sense we are more connected. Global village, as we said. You be in Afghanistan, you can FaceTime and speak to your people in London and anywhere, but at the same time more fragmented. More fragmented. And the fragmentation is a factor of many things. Of course, there are no absolute answers. It's a good question. I do not know if the answer is good. But some reflections, I'll give you some reflections, because part of the Q&A is also to enrich my own knowledge and focus my thinking more. I think there's a number of factors. A number of factors being diplomacy failing in many ways. Extremism that comes through wrong interpretations. Wrong interpretations of the Quran, wrong interpretations of the teachings of the Hadith and the teachings of the Prophet, peace be upon him. ISIS. It was politics that basically created ISIS. Politics created ISIS, thinking that it was a good idea because then we can have somebody else fight it for us in Syria. And of course, the monster came out of the bottle, came out of the, and they wouldn't go back, and is biting the hands of those that fed it. In your own country, Mujahideen became Taliban. They helped the Mujahideen, which became Taliban, and then of course the Taliban did what they did. It's a combination of factors. I wish I had the answers to that, because if you have the answers, if you have the diagnosis, you can give the proper prescription. But it's a combination of things. That's why everything is connected to everything else. And that is why everybody has to do their share. Everybody has to. You have to do your share. If the world is not saved, it's because your fault. That is the thinking that we have to do. The same thing goes for me, goes for everybody. They are we. That's the way I look at it. It's failure of diplomacy, of course, interests which are always the personal interest that translates itself to a national interest, to a global interest. Thrasymachus in the Peloponnesian War, he says, the strong suffer what the strong get what they can, but the weak must suffer what they can. Nowadays, the resolutions of the United Nations, or my own country, they're not being implemented. But the fact that we strive to that, the fact that we have the resolutions, the fact that we have a point of reference, which is the charter, it's another story. We didn't have that. Countries like my own, small countries, would have disappeared. Would have disappeared from the face of the earth, not just Cyprus, many. Okay? Now we are in the same table as the United Kingdom, in the Commonwealth, and a country like Cyprus, Malta, Fiji, Jamaica, taking the floor and saying, listen, I'm sorry, this is not correct, for these reasons. Mm-hmm. And the United Kingdom has to come along. We're no longer speaking about the British Commonwealth. Maybe it would have been in the past. That's why I said how this Commonwealth came about. I think that really needs to be studied effectively, because we fought the British. We fought the British. It was bloody fights, but we managed to stay together. And that has the way it came, of course, through trade, interest, cultural diplomacy, and training the people's minds. Our people, our lawyers are trained in the United Kingdom. You know, we have common law, Brexit or no Brexit, but Cyprus and Malta will be the only two countries now in the EU that will promulgate the Commonwealth agenda and they will have this situation, whatever that might mean, because Cyprus and Malta together, of course, we don't make up for the gravitas of the United Kingdom. Thank you, a good question. I hope I give you some sort of an answer, Karine. Yeah. Vincent?
Yeah, from Nigeria.
Niger or Nigeria?
Nigeria.
Nigeria, yeah. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Shoot.
Thank you for the excellent presentation. I really appreciate all what you have said because you have cleared some doubts in my mind and then, you know, concerning the issue of cultural diplomacy. I find my way here because I'm in kind of search for peace, you know, especially back home in my country where issue of Boko Haram, you know, have,
yes. Yes.
But, sir, my question is, to what extent do you think cultural diplomacy can, you know, actually bring a world peace, a global peace, you know, looking at the United Nations having the major goal of, you know, for sustainable of a global peace, and which to me they have failed in some area, looking at the crisis in maybe in Nigeria, in Sudan, in Syria, and what have you, being caused by religion.
Yeah. Yeah. And I see your point. Yeah. Vincent, thank you. It's a very good question. Very often the frustration is that we, because we live in an instant society, okay, instant coffee, instant fast food, instant, there is a frustration when it comes to cultural diplomacy because you don't see, like I said, immediate results. It's a long-term process. Not to be underestimated, not to be overestimated, and one has to see it in a continuum. Your people, 50 years ago, were being hanged by trees in America. I can show you some pictures of a black little girl, go to Twitter, go to historical pics, and you will see it, a black little girl that in a European country was put in a zoo. And this is 50, 60 years ago. Now, we have come a long way since. Is hatred eradicated? No. Is discrimination eradicated? No. Do we need to do a lot more work? Of course we do a lot more work, but at least slowly, brick by brick, we're getting there. There are ups, there are downs, but we have a point of reference. Now everybody can really claim their human rights. They are all equal before the law. And the referendums, of course, whether it is Brexit, whether it is other referendums, and the results of them, it's also, as Jonathan said, a disconnect of the people with the elite, because exactly they feel that they're not delivering on these issues. I no longer say that I'm a high commissioner or an ambassador. Because somewhere along the line there is a sense, well, you're fine, I mean, you go to your receptions, you have a car driving you around, and you have some money. I cannot make ends meet, somebody says. Screw you. And that is reflected in the frustration. The whole idea is to really have the dialogue to, and one additional thing that I'm on Twitter is to show, to take the mystique away and to show what I'm doing. Working a certain part of my anatomy, something like, 14, 16 hour day, including weekends. Now, I share the frustration, and every time on social media, you have the positive things you have at any given time. I don't know how many thousands of postings by terrorist organizations. Somebody moves the clock, the watch to the left, it means, you know, go ahead and attack. So, but we have to address all these issues. And the problem is the balance, of course. You do not want to have Big Brother in your bedroom. On the other hand, you want to feel safe. You want to be here and talk without being afraid of being blown up, or send your kids to school, or go to church and worship and being afraid that somebody will blow you up. I'm not giving you a correct answer, Vincent, but okay. There are always good questions. Be careful about the answers, because they're no good. So anybody else, please. And then it's 12:15, and you need to have your coffee and please. Any time. I have all the time. I work 26 hours a day. So don't worry about it.
Good morning, Your Excellency. I'm Peter Farrugia. I work with the Office of the President of Malta.
Peter Farrugia.
Yeah, Peter.
Great pleasure.
My question will concern not the Commonwealth necessarily, but the Mediterranean. One of the things we like to talk about in the President's office is a Mediterranean which can link together the northern and southern shores of the sea. My question to you, however, is how useful is it to talk about the Mediterranean? Because within the European Union, it's a southern neighborhood. US foreign policy barely acknowledges the Mediterranean. It's collapsed into other parts of the world. The Union for the Mediterranean never really materialized. So can cultural diplomacy within our region create a sense of synergy between these really quite different and in some ways fragmented places, which are linked together by thousands of years of history, but what else?
Okay. First of all, I want to pay tribute to Malta, and I want to pay tribute to what Malta has done in the world. Many people forget that it is not the size of the country that matters. Of course, size matters. No, nobody says differently. But the size of the idea, implementable idea, and it was Ambassador Arvid Pärto of Malta, who in 1974 said that the oceans, of course, including the Mediterranean, are the common heritage of mankind. The common heritage of mankind. It's not yours, it's not mine, it is common. Simple idea, slogan, a buzzword. From there comes out a seabed committee. I'm sorry, he said it in 64, 65. 67, 74, we have the Cyprus Committee. 74 till 82, we had the third United Nations Conference on the Law of the Sea, which was the biggest ever multilateral conference at the United Nations. And we came out with the Montego Agreement of 1982, which is the Law of the Sea Convention, which governs the oceans. So when you read about delimitations, when you read about exploration, exploitation of the deep seabed, all these things have their genesis in the ideas of Malta, okay? Because people have the tendency to dismiss small countries. Who cares? Malta, Cyprus, irrelevant. No. In an interconnected world, you are as strong as the weakest link. And especially now, when islands like my own, like Malta, like anywhere, they're not so small if you look at it on the map and when you put in the territorial sea, the contiguous zone, the exclusive economic, the continental shelf, and the wealth that comes from these things. Now, Mediterranean and the Eastern Mediterranean, now I become nationalistic, okay? Cradle of civilization, okay? You have Egypt, you have Israel, you have the Mediterranean at the crossroads of three continents. Anybody that wanted to go east, west, north, south had to dominate the Mediterranean, okay? I think it is, as you say, the United States and perhaps United Kingdom barely acknowledging the situation. I would disagree because you put it in absolute terms. I mean, the United States still has its sixth fleet. United Kingdom has bases on Cyprus, 50, 60 years after independence, and it's not by accident that this is so. If the Eastern Mediterranean and the Mediterranean falls into unfriendly or potentially unfriendly hands, this is not compatible with the interest of the EU. And in order to do that, you need hard power. It's not that you don't need hard power. It's not everything happy-go-lucky, soft, I love you, you love me, thank you. Of course we do. But I think it has a huge role to play in promoting these values through cultural diplomacy. Now, it doesn't mean that the Union of the Mediterranean, you know, the idea is there, but on the implementation, it lacks. My president has had trilateral meetings, summits, with Egypt, with Israel, together with the Greek prime minister. This is the Eastern Mediterranean we're talking now about, where, because, among other things, energy was discovered, and we see energy in the Eastern Mediterranean as a game changer, much the same way, and I'm not daydreaming, perhaps I am, the coal and steel was for the EU. Who would have said, before the EU would have established, when, you know, Jean Monnet and the founding fathers of the EU, they said, okay, brick by brick, coal and steel, let's get together for the French and the Germans. You had to solve the German question. And the German question on the European continent was solved through soft power, through diplomacy, through trade, through understanding. Now, why can I not transpose that in the Mediterranean? So, okay, if I am fatalistic, if I am patronizing, if I am constantly a pessimist, it ain't gonna go anywhere, okay? Turn the page without tearing it up and move forward, being also a realist. Because if you're just a professor at the university, let me get back to my professors now, that you just talk theory, it ain't gonna happen. Anyhow, if I'm answering to you, Peter, but I love Malta. You have done a lot on cultural diplomacy, on diplomacy itself, on the Mediterranean. Bravo, you have done wonders.
Thank you.
And today, Malta is the chairman in office in the Commonwealth, by the way, and there will be chairman, president of the EU, and they hosted a very successful Commonwealth summit in Valletta, and actually the Wi-Fi was working constantly. And I cannot find the Wi-Fi that works here constantly. It keeps dropping. Here, I mean, in London. Yeah. You know, well, maybe here too. Yeah. Please.
Yes. I'm Celine from Turkey.
From?
Turkey. What's your Celine. Name? Celine.
Celine.
Yes.
Nicholson.
Teşekkür ederim. Yeah. I'm fine. Thank you very much.
Yes.
I'm working as a freelance reporter and also doing my PhD, media and culture for conflict resolution.
Okay.
I would like, firstly, really thank you very much for your enlightening speech. I can't imagine that how did we come from the ping pong diplomacy till Twitter diplomacy, really. It is amazing point.
Good point.
Celine. Yes, yeah. And you mentioned about Egypt and also Tunisia, the role of the Twitter for the Arab Spring.
I could have mentioned the attempt.
Yeah, coup. Yes, coup. Uh-huh. Yeah. Yes, 15 July.
Yeah.
Yes, but really. They are the good news and good examples, but I don't want to be pessimistic, but sometimes people and some groups, they are using Twitter diplomacy or digital diplomacy in a bad way. For example, some groups like Pegida or ISIS, Boko Haram, they are using in a bad way, and they are calling, they are making some announcements, and they are calling the youth from the European countries to join their bad ideology, to fight for their ideology. So could you please give some details to decrease decrease this kind of examples all over the world?
I think it is.
Thank you.
Thank you too. Very good. Chok mercy. I think it's a very, very valid point. We speak about the downside of all these things. But in the end, and I know I'm repeating myself because I don't have any easy answer to that. Huh? I don't have an easy answer because just as we are free to do all these things on the internet, cost-free because they give you a free platform, the other side does the same. By the other side, I mean the terrorists, they're the ones that don't share our values and they want to do us harm. I think this is done not again through hard power, you will need hard power. I'm not saying you don't need hard power, but this is not done through hammering people on the head. The more you hammer people on the head, the more radicalized they become. I think individually, everyone to fight against these things in a positive way, and then the collectivity of all these things, hopefully it will change the mindset. Because I can get a new car, I can get a new bicycle, but how do you get a new head? And how do you get a new mind? And these things are done easily through, on the contrary, but they're done slowly. It comes to do with education. It has to do with family upbringing. It has to do with the golden rule of all religions, which is simple. Do unto others as you would have others do unto you. Mm. If you were me, how would you feel? If I was you, how would I feel? Now, why is it so difficult to do it? Again, you come back to national to interests as defined by them. You come down to megalomania. You come down to regaining lost empires because I want to have more and more and more and more. Okay, but you know, I think that's the only way that I can see going forward. I mean, you can, of course, there are technical ways too. I mean, you can block. You can have a regime, for instance, of if you have hate crimes and people, you can report them. They should be blocked. Okay, but at the end of the day, it's going to be in the free market of ideas. You know, how can somebody be raised in this country too, in other countries, and then feel so alienated that he or she becomes a terrorist? And I'm not trying to justify terrorism in any way, shape, or form. And I'm distinguishing between, and which is a fine distinction, and we can talk about it for the next 2-3 hours. Now, who is a terrorist and who is a freedom fighter? Nelson Mandela was considered a terrorist, huh? Okay? But we saw how he was accepted and how he's seen as a man of peace reconciliation. So today's terrorists can become somebody like Mandela. That's Mandela could have come out of prison saying, listen, guys, you were doing it to me all these years. You were doing it to me, to my people all these years. Now it's my turn. I'll do it to you. And I will do it even more viciously. He didn't do that. And I think that is the narrative that we have to internalize. And it's not easy. Because the human reaction, you did it to me, I'll do it to you. Mm-hmm. It's not an eye for an eye, but it's an eye, it's a tooth for a jaw. Çok merci, and let's talk about it. I offer the best Turkish cup of coffee in London. Huh? I don't have my card, but Christina will give you.
Hi, I'm Faye. I'm very interested.
You're Faye?
Faye.
Yeah.
I'm very interested in humanity.
From where, Faye?
Well, I belong to UPF.
And England, finally, somebody.
And England.
A genuine Anglo-Saxon.
And ex-South Africa, so I'm very passionate about Mandela and all the changes that happened there. Thank you very much for your speech. On a cultural basis, you touched on so many important facts like the education, the universal, trying to bring about where children aren't just radicalized through the media, through the Twitters and things. We have to also look from the cultural point of view, the people who are providing, because you were saying corruption is also a bonus. The very people who are talking about providing wonderful sanctuary for these the innocent people caught up amongst the conflicts that are going on are the people who are providing the ammunition, the armory. It's a financial gain that they get, and they hide behind bureaucracy, they hide behind governments, they get anonymity. So how can we be preaching this cultural diplomacy and not expose this kind of naming and shaming and stopping the brunt of it? If you didn't have the ammunition, you can't do friendly fire. And making sure, it's the same with the ISIS concept and Boko Haram. They kidnap children, they still haven't found all of them two years later. And yet we have all the security and international.
Okay, I'm sorry.
No, we have all the so-called security international who pride themselves on being able to find innocent kids whose lives have now been ruined and everything else that goes on. Yeah. there's an important issue here, and the issue is that people who do harm on innocent people, you preach human rights. The people who are proactively instigating, enabling, providing an access to it, providing transport for it, because there's money involved,
yes,
you have to hit them at that level. And education is the best form. Yeah. These young kids who are being radicalized in this country, if you got married at a certain age, it would be sexual assault, it would be pedophilic. And yet they promote it in these countries. There's nothing glamorous about it.
Yeah.
We need international diplomacy to make the children aware in an international level what's very acceptable.
It's
in an idealistic manner.
No. It's very good. And all the questions actually have been fantastic. Like I said, I'm not sure how the answers were, because if we had the answers, you know, we would all of us... if I said that corruption equals bonus, I was trying to, at that point, I was trying to say how words have changed their meaning, because we're brainwashed to cover up some corruption is corruption. But we may call it, it's a bonus, or if you do this, I will do this for you, you know, an added value. It is what it is. So we have to be very, very careful. But I think not all is lost. I mean, you have UNESCO, you have UNICEF, you have the United Nations, for that matter, the Commonwealth as well, and other regional organizations that very often we see the most visible, the most poignant, the most political. You know, we see the tip of the iceberg, but we don't see what's happening underneath the iceberg. And underneath the iceberg is a lot of things are happening, underneath the sea level. Not underneath the iceberg, the sea level. You see the tip of the iceberg, and then so look at it. There's a lot of things that are happening in UNICEF. There's a lot of things that are happening at the United Nations. There's a lot of things that are happening in the Commonwealth. And I think these things, and I agree with you, it comes through education. It's not an easy process. It's slowly. But we have to attack radicalization and its roots. And it's not easy. It's not easy because, you know, I mean, genital mutilation. Well, it's my culture, it's my tradition. Well, yeah, and then try to argue, listen, it's not the case. And if, you know, there was marriage in the 12th, 13th century with a 9-year-old, that doesn't mean you get married nowadays with a 9-year-old, you know. So all these things, they come through education, they come through society. I know it's not easy, but listen, as terrible as the world is still a better place than it was 40, 50 years ago, in terms of health, in terms of empowerment of the citizen, in terms of not taking SHIT from anyone. I mean, you have to fight your rights, empowerment. Are we there? We have a rich nirvana. Maybe if you're Norway or Switzerland, maybe, you know, and I don't know which countries have reached nirvana, but our world hasn't, and many of our countries, including my own, has yet to do it. At the end of the day, we all have to believe of being citizens of the world, and we all have to do our share. Don't think that you do not count. Revolutions, we are all started by the few. And I'm not advocating a violent revolution, of course not. But it started by the few. In fact, that is the course of history. It's the few that done it, for good or ill. A Hitler was one, and then slowly became a Hitler. And we all know what's happening. So what can I say? If anybody has any other ideas on answering some of these questions, throw them in.
Thank you very much, Your Excellency. We very much appreciate your lecture.
Health, happiness, prosperity, and every success, the High Commission is at your disposal whenever you want to come, with pleasure. I mean, we host different things in different times with our limited means and limited budget, but we try to do our very, very, very best. And of course, maybe give you the plug. Feel free to follow me on Twitter. You know, I need to get my numbers up. No, because again, they tell, you know, coming seriously, you know, they think that numbers are important, and I suppose they are important, but also quality and what you're trying to do is much more important. I euphemistically say, listen, when Jesus started, he only had 12 disciples. you know, and he lost one on the way. But look what is happening now. I do not know Mohammed, peace be upon him, how many disciples he had, but you see. Anyhow, this is a joke, but I would urge everybody to use social diplomacy in a positive way. And thank you, Jonathan, for staying to listen or non-listen to. I'm sorry I missed your soul. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Your Excellency, and definitely I will take you up on your offer to continue the dialogue and cooperation. We'd love to support you and also the High Commission any way that we can.